So recent stats from the Gambling Commission show that quite a lot of people gamble in any one year. Men slightly more than women. National lottery very popular. Young adults, because they're more attracted to risk taking, make up a big percentage. Number of problem gamblers has risen, and we've got just about 500,000 problem gamblers in the country. But again, we've got about 2 million people who are at risk. And there are different screening tools to use, but it's not for today's talk, but I can give a talk about these things. Okay, great. Men are gambling more than women. In some countries, this gender divide is equal, so it's more about cultural factors, I feel, than much else. Spread betting attracts problem gamblers, as do playing machines and bookmakers. Roulette online, really problematic as well. FOBTs, I won't spend time on this, but fixed odds betting terminals, if any of you are interested in gambling, you should read up about this and the really strong movement against them that many of you in this room have been involved in to get the government to reduce the maximum stake, and they have agreed to do so. I'd like to see a faster than 2-year turnaround, but that's a different matter. Media has played a big part in getting people to be aware of the gambling industry and what it needs to do to really protect the population more. About 8,000 people in treatment at any one time. GamCare, Gordon Moody, and the National Problem Gambling Clinic are the providers at present. One more clinic about to start in Leeds that we're all very excited about. No time for you to see this. I've talked about gender. And there are barriers for seeking treatment in women. The main one being, from what I've encountered, is that people are very scared of having their children taken away. Very, very scared. And so they may wait a long time to come and get help. I've covered most of this. High levels of homelessness, as you can imagine, in gamblers. Physical health issues and social isolation as they leave their family home. I've mentioned impulsivity, and I've mentioned impaired functioning in terms of the decision making, and I've mentioned genetics already. So high levels of comorbidity, substance use disorders, mood disorders. The substance use misuse not really concurrent, whereas the mood and anxiety disorders are frequently concurrent. We treated with cognitive behavioral therapy. 8 sessions work very well. Cambridge University Press has just taken over our textbook, our manual, and is turning it into our textbook so you can all use it as soon as it's published. We're very excited.